Hello friends, I am Mr. Sanjeev B.Naik, working as Assistant Professor in Mechanical Engineering Department, Walchand Institute of Technology, Solapur. In this video, I am explaining about the friction in the worm, which is considered during power transmission, and its thermal power rating, based upon which it can transmit safely a power on thermal consideration. So at the end of the session, students will be able to understand friction considerations in the design of the worm gas and design of worm gas for thermal power rating. As we know that the worm gear pair consists of a worm and worm wheel. The worm being in the form of helical screw and worm wheel is similar to helical gear, the sliding friction is predominant between the worm and worm wheel. So this is a basic difference between the worm gear pair and other gear pairs, and that's why frictional losses are quite heavy and frictional forces are also quite heavy, and that's why coefficient of friction in worm gear drive is an important requirement in design. And this has been observed that the coefficient of friction in worm gear drive depends upon its rubbing speed. The rubbing speed is the relative velocity between the worm and worm wheel. So here we consider a triangle in which we can find out the rubbing velocity Vs if we know the peripheral or pitchline velocity of the worm and pitchline velocity of the worm wheel. So considering this velocity triangle, we can establish to know the rubbing velocity, and based upon rubbing velocity there is a coefficient of friction. So the geometry is considered here to calculate the rubbing velocity Vs, which is Vn upon cos gamma. Gamma is a lead angle, and where pitchline velocity we know that it is pi dn upon 60. 1 and n1 stands for worm speed and worm diameter. So pi, pitch circle diameter of the worm, and speed of the worm divided by 60 into 1000, because diameter is always in mm, whereas V1 we require in meters per second. So that's why considering this equation, we can calculate the pitchline velocity of the worm, and once we know pitchline velocity, we can calculate sliding or rubbing velocity in this fashion. Once we know sliding or rubbing velocity, then by using this standard chart, we can calculate or we can know what is the coefficient of friction. So here two assumptions are made in the standard chart. One is the worm wheel is made of phosphor bronze and the worm is made of case hardened steel. So normally in many of the cases, the worm wheel is phosphor bronze and the worm is made up of case hardened steel. So this is a peculiar combination is considered for the materials. And also the lubrication method is concerned, that is having viscosity 16 to 130 centistokes at 60 degree centigrade, measured at 60 degree centigrade, a particular lubricating oil, which is a mineral oil. So considering these two standard conditions, this standard chart is available. So here we can find out the rubbing speed as we have made use of triangle and we have calculated rubbing speed. So corresponding to this rubbing speed, we can establish the coefficient of friction. So this is the way the coefficient of friction can be established for worm and worm wheel. Now, as I said that the frictional losses are quite heavy in case of worm gear drive, the efficiency also is a matter which has been comparatively less as compared to other gear drives. And how to calculate this efficiency is something like this. We know that the mechanical efficiency is power output by power input. In case of worm gear drive, the output is always been considered to be taken from worm wheel, and whereas it is assumed that the input supplied is always to the worm. So we consider power output from worm wheel and power input to the worm. So corresponding, we take torque into speed is the power. If you take torque into angular speed is the power. So here we consider the torque as tangential load into radius is the torque. So tangential force acting on the worm wheel multiplied by pitch radius of the worm wheel, which is essentially diameter by 2, and angular speed is 2 pi n by 60, but here also 2 pi n by 60 gets cancelled, and we can get just the speed RPM n2 of the worm wheel. And similarly, power input is a tangential force acting on the worm multiplied by its pitch radius is a torque multiplied by the speed. So this is the another equation we can use for input power. So this is the way we get the ratio. Once we get this ratio as efficiency, here we get the N2 by N1 as one factor, N2 by N1. So this is what the speed factor. So what is the speed ratio? Actually, it is N1 by N2. The speed ratio is speed of the worm by speed of the worm mill. So it should be N1 by N2 is equal to I. So definitely N2 by N1 becomes 1 upon I. So I get N2 by N1 is 1 upon I. Similarly, I can get D2 by D1 because 2 gets cancelled. So if I want to know ratio D2 by D1 is here. D2 is the pitch circle diameter of the worm wheel, which is calculated as M into Z2. So in my previous videos, we have seen terminology. We find that pitch circle diameter of the worm wheel is M into Z2. Similarly, pitch circle diameter of the worm is M into Q. So that's why finally D2 by D1 is Z2 by Q. So just for some simplicity, we divide numerator and denominator by Z1. So Z2 by Z1 is also speed ratio. So we have seen in terminology, the velocity ratio or speed ratio is also Z2 by Z1. And that's why it is I. Z2 by Z1 is value I. And tan of gamma, this relationship also we know from lead triangle. Tan of gamma, where gamma is the lead angle, Z1 by Q. So thereby we want Q by Z1, so it is 1 upon tan of gamma. So tan gamma comes over here. So finally, Z2 by Q is nothing but I tan gamma. So that's why D2 by D1 can be replaced by I tan gamma and N2 by N1 by 1 by I. And finally, we can find out here something that efficiency is further P2T by P1T. Then D2 by D1 is I tan gamma and N2 by N1 is 1 upon I. And that's why we get this relationship, that is P2T by P1T into tan of gamma. Further, we know that P2T, that is the tangential force on the worm wheel, is equal to axial force on the worm. Just in force analysis in previous video, we have seen that the tangential force on worm wheel is axial force on the worm. So we can replace this P2T by P1A, and that's why it becomes P1A upon P1T into tan of gamma. Further, this P1A in terms of P1T, we have see that we can convert it likewise. So axial force on worm is equal to tangential force on the worm into this bracket, cos alpha cos gamma minus mu sin gamma cos alpha sin gamma plus mu cos gamma. So this is the way we can convert P1A to P1T. So that P1T and P1T gets cancelled, and just we get the efficiency as a tan of gamma into this bracket, cos alpha cos gamma minus mu sin gamma cos alpha sin gamma plus mu cos gamma. So this is the relationship to find out the efficiency of the worm gear, in which we require to know only three parameters. One is the lead angle, one is the pressure angle, and one is the coefficient of friction. So by this way, we can able to know the efficiency of the worm gear drive. Further, substituting tan gamma is a sin by cos, so we can simplify further in this equation also. That is, efficiency is cos alpha minus mu tan gamma upon cos alpha into mu cot gamma. So this is the two equations which can be used to calculate efficiency of worm gear drive. So students, pause the video and just recall how the efficiency of helical and spur gears is there as compared to the worm gears, just we have seen. Now, being the loss is more as a frictional work done or friction between the spur and worm gear as a worm and worm wheel, they have got comparatively very less efficiency. If you compare, the efficiency of spur and helical gears is very high in terms of 98% to 99%, whereas in case of worm gears, it is very low. It varies between 50 to 98%, sometimes even less than 50 in self-locking conditions also. So this is why, as this frictional work done is very large, the heat generated is also more. And if these gears are continuously being operated, then this thermal concentration must be there. That is, heat generated becomes predominant, and that should be known. And heat generated is 1000 into 1 minus efficiency to kilowatt. So whatever frictional work done is a loss of efficiency, 1 minus efficiency is a loss of efficiency. And that is directly converted into heat. So this is equation which we can use for heat generated. So, for smooth working and safe working, this generated heat must be effectively dissipated through the lubricating oil to the housing wall of the gearbox and finally to the surrounding air. So that's why the rate of heat dissipated is HD, which has been calculated as key into T minus K into T minus T naught into E. So HD is the heat dissipated through the wall, K is the overall heat transfer coefficient of housing wall, T is the temperature of the oil, and T naught is the temperature of the surrounding air. So this becomes a temperature difference, and A is the effective surface area of housing. So under thermal equilibrium condition, the heat generated must be heat dissipated. So equating these two, we can just know how much power safely the gear can transmit as a kilowatt, as K into T minus T naught A upon 1001 minus efficiency. So by knowing the efficiency, we can also know how much power safely the worm gear pair can transmit without accumulating the heat. So whatever heat generated continuously, it is continuously dissipated. So this is the way becomes a thermal considerations in design of the worm gear drive to know its power transmitting capacity. My reference is Design of Machine Elements. Thank you.